This video is brought to you by Squarespace. Create a beautiful website without having to write a single line of code. The MIRI Medium Resolution Spectrograph is back in business, and that brings the James Webb Space Telescope back to full science capability. And a special working group has figured out a way to minimize the risk of micrometeoroid impacts. Short version, Webb will now look behind instead of forward. I'll explain that one in a bit, but first, let's talk about MIRI coming back into full service. In August, one of MIRI's grating wheels started to register some higher than expected friction whenever it was rotated. These wheels are called dichroic grating assemblies, or DGAs. They rotate to present different combinations of beam splitters, the dichroics, and diffraction gratings that route the light into the four different channels of MIRI's medium resolution spectrograph, or MRS. I talked about how the MRS works in some detail in my previous video about this problem, but to recap, the DGA wheels rotate so the four channels record 1/3 of the total spectrum at a time. With each rotation, the rest of the spectrum is filled out. When one of the two DGA wheels showed more friction than expected, the MIRI team suspended the use of MRS while they analyzed the problem. On November 8, NASA announced that the friction problem was resolved and MRS was returned to full service. The official statement said that a review concluded that the friction occurred under certain conditions and that the team developed a new procedure for using the wheel during science operations. The new procedure was tested on November 2nd and the wheel performed exactly as predicted. MRS mode was returned to full science observations 10 days later and it's been running ever since. In fact, the first spectrum that MRS took was of Saturn's polar regions. This was possible thanks to a lucky combination of Saturn's axial tilt, its orbital inclination, and Webb's location near the top of its L2 orbit. In fact, this particular alignment won't occur again for another 20 years. So as an astronomer, I'm thrilled to know that MRS is back in business and taking data. But as an obsessively curious nerd, I really like to know what those conditions are that causes friction and what was done in terms of how MRS is now able to operate. MIRI's user documentation doesn't indicate any changes in how MRS observations are implemented. Still, the statement just seems a little vague, and I can't seem to find anything that indicates how the problem was actually resolved. I don't know why somebody from Team MIRI hasn't called me up by now to tell me. I mean, after all, I have the pin. Meanwhile, a working group investigating that large micrometeoroid strike in May announced a plan for how to further reduce the risk of future impacts. I'll tell you more about the details in a moment, but first I'd like to thank Squarespace for sponsoring today's video. Squarespace is designed to give you everything you need to get a new website up and running without having to write a single line of code. To get started, simply choose from one of the many mobile, responsive templates and use their suite of built-in tools to upload your content. I'm building a new site for our annual workshop for writers, and it's amazing just how easy and intuitive it is. With its new Fluid Engine, I can move and resize elements and know they'll always line up with the overall layout of the site. You can add any type of content, whether it's photos, videos, newsletter signups, e-commerce, or virtually anything else you can imagine. Connect your social media accounts to display posts from your social profiles right on your website. Setting up a mailing list is a breeze. Start with an email template, apply your brand assets, and you're on your way. If you need a website done fast and well, then you owe it to yourself to go to squarespace.com/launchpadastronomy for a free trial, and you can save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. You'll find that link in the description below. NASA announced its findings from a working group investigating the micrometeoroid impact on Webb's MIRI in May of 2022, and this occurred while the science instruments were still being commissioned. Even though micrometeoroids are just the size of a grain of sand, they're traveling at tens of kilometers per second, so they still pack a lot of kinetic energy. At 25 square meters, JWST's MIRI is the largest ever flown. Since it has to operate at cryogenic temperatures, the MIRI has to be exposed to open space so it can passively cool. It was always understood that Webb would be hit by micrometeoroids, so they built the mirror to perform at a level much higher than is required for science. And this way, as the mirror accumulates impacts, it will still deliver science-quality images over the course of its mission. Even better, Webb's mirror segments can be adjusted to cancel out some of the effects of those impacts. And this mitigation strategy was based on modeling the micrometeoroid environment at L2 long before Webb was ever launched. And they estimated that Webb's mirror should accumulate one or two hits a month, with most of those hits being so tiny they could effectively be canceled out by routine mirror adjustments. Now that's true of the tiny strikes, but maybe once every couple of years or so, the mirror should be hit by something a little larger, like the one that hit back in May. To make matters worse, it hit on a part of the segment that couldn't be fully corrected either. Each segment has six actuators arranged in a hexapod, with a seventh actuator at the center. Had the impact occurred near one of these actuators, the deformation would have been more correctable. Instead, the impact occurred at a location where there wasn't as much control authority available. Still, after correcting for as much as they could, the mirror's performance is still twice as good as it needs to be to produce science. This is the final selfie image of the mirrors that were taken after the corrections were put into place. It looks worse than it really is because this image isn't a picture of a crater. Rather, it depicts the amount of wavefront error across all of the mirror segments. So if the telescope's optics were just exactly perfect, then all of the light waves bouncing off every point on the mirror's surface would combine into a perfectly flat wavefront that goes into the telescope. But there's no such thing as a perfect mirror. So there's always going to be some tiny amount of imperfection in the wave's flatness. And this imperfection is the wavefront error. After correcting for the May impact as much as possible, the telescope's wavefront error was brought down to about 59 nanometers RMS. And that's about 9 nanometers greater than it was before the impact. To be clear, the impact itself is probably just a tiny little crater on the surface, maybe a couple of millimeters. But it delivered enough energy such that the surrounding surface was deformed ever so slightly from its optimal shape. And this is why you can't even tell there's a problem by looking at these beautiful images. And there isn't nearly enough degradation to impact the science quality either. In fact, the error introduced by the impact is much less than the inherent errors introduced by the rest of the observatory and the instruments themselves. However, there is another problem of sort in that Webb seems to have enough fuel on board to last for at least the next 20 years. And that's the official statement from NASA. Unofficially, though, there's now some talk about 25 plus years of fuel remaining. So given that this impact happened earlier than expected, and given that Webb could be around for a lot longer than planned, NASA decided to convene a working group to think about the problem a little more. They announced their results on the November 15th entry on Webb's blog. As of publication, Webb had accumulated 14 impacts since launch. And that works out to about 1 to 2 impacts per month, which is exactly what the predictions were before launch. This led the working group to conclude that the May impact was very unlucky, but nevertheless statistically consistent. In other words, yeah, it was a fluke. But they also found that on average, micrometeoroids striking the mirror head-on are moving twice as fast as those striking the mirror in the same direction as the telescope's motion. Now, since kinetic energy goes as the velocity squared, an impact in the forward ram direction will generate 4 times the energy as an impact in the rear-facing wake direction of the telescope. Now, that's an average, of course, because the individual velocities of the micrometeoroids will vary. Still, if Webb could avoid pointing in the ram direction as much as possible, it should reduce the collision energy by a factor of 4. Now, Webb is already constrained on where in the sky it can safely point to because it has to keep its shield facing the sun at all times. And this sets up a circular region called the field of regard. As Webb orbits the sun, different parts of the sky enter into this field. Now, over a 6-month period, Webb will see everything in the entire sky. So a fixed target in roughly the same plane as Webb's orbit enters the field of regard twice a year. Once as Webb is moving toward the target, and then again 6 months later as Webb is moving away. So NASA has imposed a new micrometeoroid avoidance zone, or MAZ. The objective is simple, point the other way. And to help astronomers plan their observations a little better, the proposal tool will give them a little bit of assistance. This tool helps astronomers to define their observations on both Hubble and Webb. It allows them to specify what targets they want to point to, what instruments they want to use, observing modes, exposure times, filters, and it tells them in turn when their target is visible and when they should expect their observations to be executed. This way, astronomers can hand off a complete observation spec to the program coordinators at the Space Telescope Science Institute. And there they actually get the observations scheduled and executed. The great thing about the planning tool is that it'll tell you if your observations are violating any constraints on things like sun angle, guide star availability, and so on. But starting next year, the tool will also advise when your observations can be scheduled in the meteoroid safe zone. But there are two reasons why it may only be possible to be done while pointing into the MAZ. One is that the observation is time sensitive, and it just happens to work out that the target is only visible during the MAZ during those opportunities. Another is if the telescope has to be oriented in a particular way to observe the target, and the only times those orientations can be achieved while keeping the shield facing the sun happens to be while the target is in the MAZ. In those situations, you'll get a warning message in the planning tool. Now, if you can replan your observations to avoid the MAZ entirely, then great, do it, make it happen. But if not, then you just enter an explanation explaining why you can't do it any other way, and the warning clears. Then you can submit your proposal, and you're good to go. And that's the thing about this new policy. It's not that they're going to prohibit observations in the MAZ, because, let's face it, the chances of a severe impact at any given time are still quite low. But they'll otherwise avoid the MAZ as much as possible. And by the way, not all targets are going to be equally affected by the MAZ constraint. Targets at high ecliptic latitudes, that is, targets that are very high above the plane of Webb's orbit around the sun, will never enter into the MAZ at all. Targets at latitudes closer to the upper and lower edges of the MAZ will find their visibility windows affected less than 50% of the time. It's only those targets that lie close to the ecliptic that are going to be the most affected. In retrospect, it seems like this was something NASA should have thought of before launch. But the fact is that you just can't think of every single possible scenario all the time. NASA is considering a large optical telescope at L2, which won't have to be kept as cold as Webb. So it's possible that this new telescope would be fitted with a baffle to help protect against strikes hitting the mirror at an angle. For now, though, a little adjustment as to how Webb is used will go a long way toward extending its useful mission life. And by the way, huge thanks to my patrons for helping to extend Launchpad Astronomy's mission, and I'd like to welcome Nick Borquez, Rick Moore, Emily O'Brien, Alexander Tuzikov, Andy Schleiss, and Eric Vermont. I hope I got your pronunciations right. I apologize. I know I didn't. But if you'd like to join me on this journey through this incredible universe of ours, well, please make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell so that you don't miss out on any new videos. Until next time, stay curious, my friend.